Welcome. Today we're actually going to talk about. Whoops, that's not where I want us to be. Let's start from the beginning, shall we? We're going to actually talk about disruptive innovation and the various types of innovation, whether or not they're disruptive or not disruptive. So part of this actually stems from some of the resources. I know the last week, I had you guys look at a different lecture, not from me, but actually from one of the other minds in the community, Clayton Christensen, who's written a lot of books on disruptive innovation. So I'm going to highlight some of the points there and just try to clarify from that. And then we're also going to talk about the 10 different types that they go over in the textbook, which is very helpful to kind of start distilling the conversation on moving from ideation and ideas and then execution. All right, so let's go ahead and start. The first piece is, what is disruptive innovation? If you're watching the last lecture on it, there's some distinctive points to it, but it varies. It's not just one idea. So it varies by whose perspective we're talking about. What market industry we're talking about, and also what are the goals of the innovation. So really what we're talking about is a novel invention, service, technology platform, a system or approach that disrupts the status quo. That's really what we're trying to do. We're not trying to do a me too. We're not trying to copy somebody else. We're trying to do something holistically different. And it doesn't have to be the product. That must be important for you to understand. Because if you just innovate product the whole time, but not other aspects of your company, it makes it much easier for somebody else to copy and do me toos and maybe outcompete you in some other ways. But when we can disrupt the status quo, that may change an industry, it may change a market or change an ecosystem that does exist now. So it creates, when we talk about disruptive innovation, we're actually creating an uneven or unfair market advantage. I didn't put unfair in this because really in this world it's a niche filling system. So meaning that you're not really considering fairness as far as who's providing what services. It's whoever provides the best service or the best products and things like that. Or some people have more money to put into their process. So it's not necessarily a fairness on that end, but it does create more fairness for consumers. That's kind of the goal. And there are ways that can be blocked, but overall, that's kind of what we're going at. So there could be a disruption of a technology. What would that look like? Well, maybe we're going to lower the cost to manufacture that technology. That's one thing. Or maybe we can develop it faster and actually deliver. Or on the flip side, we could do something the opposite, where, well, maybe it's a lower quality, but we're going to establish a market in an area. Or maybe we go the opposite direction. Maybe we go higher performance at a lower price. So overall, what we're trying to do, regardless of which direction we go, and we're going to talk about more about on the different directions of development that you can do, but what we're trying to provide is a higher value proposition or an HVP to a user than what the status quo is providing now. So, from Clayton Christensen's book, Innovator's Dilemma, which was one of the most sought after books after it came out, kind of encapsulates some of this where maybe there's this performance demand at the high end and a performance demand at the low end. And really, people have different categories of what their needs are. So maybe this is a progress of sustaining innovation. So let's say this is just a company that's steady progressing from lower performance to higher performance, right? So, and oftentimes this also goes up the slope of price. It can also go the slope. Up the slope of performance. And this is time on the x-axis. So maybe at time A, the dominant market holder or company an industry was operating up here at this high end of the market. Well, this left an opportunity open for a disruptive group or maybe a startup who starts at a much lower performance end, but they've actually dove in and they've overtaken this low performance market. Why? Partly because this high-end performer isn't really getting margins on that anymore and doesn't care anymore. So this is a little bit reiterating what the last discussion that we said. Maybe at time B then, if you notice, they're on a steeper slope of disruptive innovation than the sustaining innovation. So actually this pace, if you notice, the slope is steeper. And so now they've gone up to the middle end of the performance. And then of course, true disruption is when they've actually disrupted the initial company or group at some later point in time C. And you can see how there's going to be a crossing there. And now basically they've made the other company become a dinosaur. And that's from the innovator's dilemma. That's really from the viewpoint of existing companies. And of course, they want to know how to prevent that. But for us in the startup world, we want to be this steep curve. We want to be this progress using disruptive innovation. We want to outpace the other companies in there and hit them where they don't see, where the blind spots are. So there's always been this thought historically of technology S-curves. What is a technology S-curve? Well, let's say we develop a technology at some point in time and we're measuring it in a certain market, market A, and measuring it also by a certain performance in that market. So classically, when they look at technology S-curves, you have this technology and it's low in performance, but over time and design effort, you get it better, better, and better, and then it starts plateauing at some point based upon the technology that's there. So, well, if you're an existing enterprise, what do you want to do? Well, we want to go up this performance curve. So maybe that tech's starting to plane. Before this tech planes completely, you want to then start investing into the next thing. And so you do, but you're still targeting the same market and also measuring the same performance. Fine. And so we get this same or the similar curve here with our new technologies that we've innovated. And so this is really kind of looking at product technologies. Maybe processors got faster or memory got cheaper and smaller. So this is what's happening over time. And then again, we have hit an before we're about to hit another plateau, we innovate within that company again. And so this becomes the S-curve growth. And so you see this trajectory, which is where those other lines of sustainable growth come from. So there's some fundamental problems with this. It doesn't take an account of disruptive technologies. It also doesn't take an account of any other performance or application outside of the ones we've defined. When in reality, there could be a completely different application or market and a completely different performance that we could be measuring. But we're not looking. And if we're not looking, we won't see it. So it's blind to us. We don't see anything. And lo and behold, if we don't do it, someone else will. We'll talk about that more when we get to future forecasting. And so some other upstart company develops Tech X, which suddenly is outpacing us, and say we're in this middle of this time, and ends up replacing our Tech 2 and starts knocking out our technology. So it becomes disruptive in that phase. And then of course they could then maybe disrupt our next technology if they start interfering. So more often than not, even though this may be the plan where they have iterations of technology and development, invariably their plans get interrupted by another upstart that comes in and knocks it out. And then they start innovating. So that is a little bit of a falsehood that this is going to go as planned. Usually it doesn't go as planned. You get maybe an iteration or two going, and then somebody else comes in and does something completely different. And it's not that they're necessarily in your market, and that's why you don't see them. They're actually in an ancillary market that they identified, and they're measuring a different performance factor but they could then come into your market later. Okay. So if you're innovating solutions in existing enterprises, that's really where innovator solution and a lot of Clayton's ideas are evolved in on helping people prevent things and also helping them understand where they need to put their money. So this didn't quite pan out the way I want. So I'm going to go left to right. So here, you have marketing needs forever are ever changing. So we need to constantly integrate an innovation program to consistently look for long, medium, and short-term developments. The also assumption is you cannot always expect that the customers know what they'll need tomorrow. And if you get too attuned with that, you're actually going to miss out on something because oftentimes they don't know what they need. So you need to invest in the research and development for new technology so that you can actually disrupt even your own products as you move forward. Also, you want to continuously take technology platforms and explore those other application spaces. Look outside of where you're actually measuring and what you're actually looking at now, so that you can then start getting into new market spaces, things like that. So this is actually a growth strategy rather than trying to look at efficiency strategy, which can get you in a pickle. This is a great model of like what WL Gore does. They're originally created Gore-Tex, among other things, but they quickly got into other areas. In fact, now they have a lot of products in the medical space. So it's a very different approach when you're, again, investing for growth here. So you also want to create policies that invest good money before it goes bad. So what does that mean? Well, again, when you start plateauing on any particular technology or product, and maybe that's reflected in sales, which is actually a terrible marker because it's kind of just a marker of where we've been from our last investment, not a measure of where we're going. But you want to be able to, while you're having great incomes and stuff coming in, instead of sitting on your laurels, that's what the time when you want to invest for growth and do new things because you don't have the capital contingencies that you will if you don't invest early enough. So you want to launch gr new growth businesses regularly when your core businesses or business is still healthy. You want to acquire a new growth business at a predetermined rhythm. So this is, for large companies, they don't have to always innovate themselves. They can innovate by acquisition. Now, that's what GE historically does. Divide business units so that you can keep patience and allow for growth so you can keep these business units small. What you would rather have is think of it as a portfolio of startups rather than one huge conglomerate. And in that way, you can keep yourself growing in all those fronts and give them, empower them to have that ability, ha empower the management of each of these business units to be able to do that. They should be like mini CEOs in all these different areas. Also, minimize new growth venture subsidization. You want them to really act like a startup. So there may be some initial funds, but then after that, they're accountable to themselves. That keeps them, I don't think on the edge is the way to do it, but it keeps them in that startup mode and then they have to find a way. Okay. Overall, you do not use money to measure health. And that was, I said that earlier. Money just measures investments made in the past, not in the future. I don't know why this popped up the different ways it did, but there it is. We'll adapt. So, what in short, if we really look at all that information from the disruptive innovation, and in summary, if you look at the back end of some of his books, there's Innovation or Solution, Innovator's Dilemma, and many others. What's next? There's several different books that you can go out and read more on that. It's this message. And unfortunately, Wall Street and corporate America doesn't always get this. But companies need to invest for growth, not for profit. By doing that, by investing just for profit, they're great at building capital and it helps investors and it helps upper management and founders and things, it does not help the company grow. It actually, that is the school of thought of just developing efficiencies. But if that's all you do, you're going to be disrupted by somebody else, by an upstart, and you won't last very long. Okay. So let's move on from what disruptive innovation is, and let's look at 10 types of innovation in a broader sense of whether you're a startup or whether you're an existing company. What are ways that you can innovate? And we have really three categories that we're using in our book, and this is actually pretty well respected viewpoint among a lot of professionals in the innovation space. So one is enterprise, focusing on innovating internally. Another one is the product itself, focusing on innovating technology, product, or service. Another one is the experience, focused on customer experience. So let's look at all these things. The first one is profit model, network structure, and process. And so this is really innovating within your organization. This one is product performance, product system, which kind of crosses over a little bit. And then finally, the service channel brand and customer engagement is really talking about how you are giving an experience overall to the customer. So we're going to go in each one of these in detail. So first, starting off with the profit model, I also like to call it the value model, because when you start saying profit, it's a loaded word, and that's the only thing people start focusing on, and usually people associate that with money. So the value model becomes in how does revenues come back into the company? So you want to look at creative ways toward new revenue streams, which actually fuels the next round of growth. Some examples of that are HP, Gillette Razors, and New York Times, where they've done those types of things. And both with regard to HP and Gillette Razors, they came up with a reverse model. So instead of charging a lot for the printer or the razor, which is where they used to get their profit models, they gave those away for relatively cheap, sometimes under cost, so that they could then sell a lot of cartridges or razors or consumables. So it's a consumable revenue stream, which becomes the bread and butter instead of the actual product. For New York Times, they had to make a completely different model. Now they still have, it's kind of a yes and model. So they still have papers, but print papers have been on decline. So instead, their newer revenue stream was developing apps. Even websites, but the websites are okay. But the apps that they have now has a subscription basis, and it bings you when there's something new, and you can actually choose which stories you want to read and which ones you don't. And for different price ranges, you can get so many stories that you get to read, and it comes right to your phone, and it's a push system. You don't have to go out and find the paper. The stories will come to you, and then you decide what you want to read. And so they can charge for a completely different mode of revenue that way. The next one is network. Now I call this connections on the other side. And really, you're innovating ways that your enterprise can connect with others, ultimately to create value. But in this way, you're touching your customer in a variety of ways. So Target's actually a good example of this. They talk about this in the book, where they've been able to leverage lots of different designers and executive teams to create exclusive items. If you've seen a lot of things like exclusively at Target, so you can find a lot of those things. So another example of this is GlaxoSmithKline. Now GlaxoSmithKline, if you're in the biotech world or pharma world, is a big player in that. And they, along with others like Eli Lilly, found that there was a time when they were getting really stuck on product lines. And they have a lot of researchers working on a whole bunch of products. And so they were able to outsource some of those initiatives with other people. And so in this case, the particular example that they're talking about in the book is where they have an open innovation sourcing for R&D. And this was to develop treatments in areas that were kind of neglected, in areas that aren't your billion-dollar blockbusters. So for them, it was great because then they can start partnering with universities and other places where the R&D really is being developed. And then later on, once there's some kind of proof in the pudding, then go in and work with them to take on that new product line. And it's really, again, innovation by acquisition, if you think about it. But it also then gives another point of contact for customers to look at how they're innovating. Then there's Natura. You may or may not have heard of this group. Here they leverage relationships with many universities. So here they're talking about 25 universities for about half of their product pipeline. And so this actually creates a not only the universities to be involved in it, but also a lot of customers involved with a lot of their product sales. And at the time this book was written, it was about 3.4 billion in sales annually. That's enormous. Structure is another one. Again, I don't know why this is animating the way it is. Now for structure, that means we're innovating ways that your enterprise can organize so that you can align with your talent, what you have, or your assets that you have, things that are intrinsic to your system that others may not have. So it's kind of like playing to your strengths. It's a similar argument there, but it's the strengths of the institution. So for one example, again, W.L. Gore, they have a flat lattice organization model. This again keeps innovation teams small, nimble. That goes kind of along with the disruptive idea. And they're very responsive to change in the marketplace. They also have employees as owners. So there's a natural incentive within the organization to do well by building growth and building new products and solving problems. Southwest Airlines came up with the model of why use a whole bunch of different types of aircraft, because every time you have different types of aircraft, you have different maintenance needs for each of those types. So instead, when they started, they said, you know what, we're going to use one aircraft, same maintenance schedule for everything. So we don't have to have all those different types of costs and different types of parts that we have to keep in. We're just going to have one type, and it's really going to streamline things. And it actually, in fact, did. It also reduced the turnaround time on airports because once they trained staff on one plane, they knew how to do all the planes in the whole fleet. So the training for that reduced turnaround time, all those types of things were factors. Whole Foods Markets, they have a decentralized management system. So if you think of what you see in a market, they actually have teams that manage the individual departments. So it's kind of taking that idea of empowerment and having small management teams to a more micro level. So even within a store, there will be management teams within that store. One that maybe does the wines, and one that does, certain food stocks and things like that, certain departments. And they get to make product placement decisions. They get to make hiring decisions, or what kind of products they want to stock, where how they want to display them, all those types of things. And it really differentiates them. Another type is process. So when we talk about process, this is where we're developing some kind of signature or superior method in which you want to accomplish your work. So example, Zipcar, if you have heard about them, it's kind of a car sharing system. Well, they designed a quote fast fleet system. They also did away with attendance so that somebody could automatically get car access once they paid. And they also have continuous tracking of the cars with technologies embedded in the cars. So they know exactly where they are. They know if there's a problem with the car. And they know also if they're having a lot of traffic in a certain area where they need a lot more cars, they can actually send more cars to certain locations depending upon demand. So they can adapt. Very cool. Another one is Toyota. Now that sounds like an established company, but they still, in their day, were very innovative. And one of the things that they really did, and this was back in the 90s, was creating a lean production. Everybody else copied them after they did this once they learned what they were doing, but they were able to massively reduce waste and excess by implementing something called just-in-time manufacturing. So what that means on a production line is that you don't have huge inventories of either materials or parts that are waiting for the next part of the manufacturing process. So that's what just-in-time manufacturing is. And it massively increased their efficiency. It also maximized their throughput. So that's kind of what lean production is all about. It's basically based off the work of Deming. That ironically, the US car manufacturers could have listened to and tried to talk to them about that, but they all ignored him. And so he went to Japan and started working with them in Toyota. And then Toyota hit us by storm. And then all of a sudden, people started listening to Deming. So it was kind of interesting. So then it finally came back full circle. Another example is IKEA. Well, one of the things they did is said, you know what? We're not going to create different furniture for everywhere we go. We're going to create the same stuff and ship it everywhere. And they call it the flat pack furniture. No variation by the region. They also didn't put instructions in multiple languages. They have very pictorial, generalized instructions. And every piece is a do-it-yourself assembly. It's not something that that they have everything assembled for you. So they saved tons of money in that, and actually people could buy the furniture for cheaper and were just fine putting it together at home. Of course, for that you probably want to have a truck, because that's pretty much, if you're going to IKEA, you're going to need something to carry that stuff. Okay, product performance. This is more where we're innovating some distinguishing features or functionality of your products. It also is going to differentiate the value of your offering. And so what are some examples of that? Making your product very simple and easy to use. That's one area that always is a winner. If the status quo is something that's really complex and difficult to use, simplification is a great way to disrupt an industry or an area. Sustainability is another one. Now, this kind of actually works with the educated populace, where they understand the importance of sustainability and not having products that are having a large carbon footprint or things like that. So there's a lot of push on there. Customization is a whole new area. Having novel features is another area. So let's take a look at some example companies. So one is Dyson. What did Dyson do? Well, they completely disrupted the vacuum market. If you take a look at vacuums prior to Dyson's entry, the majority of vacuums all used bag-based suction systems, where you would capture everything in a bag and then the suction would actually filter through. But as the bag filled up, the suction would go down. And of course, that's their claim to fame. You'd never lose suction. They created this dual cyclone technology. Now it took about 5,000 prototypes. The only way they could do that is because they were an existing company with other products outside of that domain. But some of the big innovations about it, not just that, was that it was bagless and it was transparent in design. So you could actually see all the dirt and everything that you were vacuuming up. And you could tell exactly when you needed to empty it. You didn't have to wait for some nefarious, strange sucking sound or no sucking sound. You actually could see when it needed to be emptied. We have one of those at home. Completely disrupted the vacuum industry. And then after that, all the others were scraping to catch up. Intuit, a local company. So, what did they do? Well, they developed TurboTax software and it really eliminated manual calculations. It was more like a wizard. When you go through a software wizard, it would ask you questions and you put in your answers and your numbers and it did the calculations for you. Much to the chagrin of many tax accountants, for most people in basic taxes, if you don't own companies and things, this is a great way to go. So, and it's much cheaper, and then you can do your taxes and file them on your own. Another one is Corning. That's a more established name. And you think about Corning, and you think like your mother's Corningware or your grandparents' Corningware, things like that, and other surfaces. But really, they made a huge play, which most people are not aware of, into the phone markets and tablet markets. They created something called Gorilla Glass. And if you look at your phone or look at your tablet or even some laptops, although they have different screens, the glass that you have is probably a Corning product. It's thin, tough, and scratch resistant. And they use it on smartphones, tablets, even TVs. And you have to think, that's over a billion devices using their product, which is, now they call this an OEM manufacturing, meaning it's a component of other products. But every one of those, they have to buy the Corning glass. So there it is. Number six, product system. This is where we're innovating complementary products and services. When we do systems innovations, we're really trying to spur ecosystems that can foster interoperability, modularity, bundling, which is actually a good feature. So some examples are what we call software development kits or SDKs. This enables other people. So for example, we use a camera in a startup that I'm affiliated with, where they have excellent software development kits in all different kinds of software platforms. So if you want to make a user interface in any one of these platforms, there's a kit to help you to do that. That interfaces with the firmware, which is the hardware that it talks to. There's application interfaces, again, ways for if you're really good at one application, aka in the software world, you can get it to interface with another application. And so it's basically ways you can send commands into and out of another application. App stores, having an app store. I mean, look at the Google App Store, or the iPhone App Store, the Apple App Store. Those actually foster other people to use those stores. And then it also fosters other people who want to develop applications for those stores. Accessories, accessorizing whatever you want, doesn't matter. Where you buy a base product and then you can accessorize the heck out of it. Great example of that is Scion. Now that's part of Toyota, so it's always within the Toyota areas, but it's a sub-brand. They were tailoring to a younger generation who wanted to customize their car. So they have hundreds of different types of parts, not just Scion parts, but they even have the open specs so that fostered third parties to make accessories for the car as well. Then there's Mozilla. What is that? Well, they made Firefox. And it's a nonprofit. And this web browser is probably the most prevalent browser on the planet. They have over 450 million users with hundreds of different plugins. And they also have an SDK platform for anybody who wants to develop plugins for their browser. So it's really using lots of people to develop the software rather than just controlling it all, which is what Apple or Microsoft or a group like that really has done in the past. Google. They developed an open source document program. So they developed programs like Google Docs, Google Sheets, and some of their other programs enough so that people would use them, and also had the foresight to say, you know what, people are going to want to interact on these documents virtually across the web. And that's where they really have made a dent into Microsoft Office products. There's hundreds of plugins, so they kept it open platform so that other people can put plugins to Google Docs to improve the features or Google Sheets to improve those features. So you can do things like statistics or charting and graphing. The next area of innovation is service. So in service, we're innovating support and increasing value of offerings. So what do service innovations do? Well, they make your customers' lives easier. Because we want to enhance the customer experience. What are some examples? You want to make something simple to use. We want to make a maintenance plan for items that they have, because maybe it's an item that has to last a long time because it's got, or it's expensive to make. And so they have maintenance plans so that it helps them. So you see that with cars and things that they start selling, giving warranties, guarantees. Also, educating your consumers and supporting their education and how to use the product properly. One example of that is Zappos. So Zappos you don't see now because they were acquired by Amazon in 2009 for a small $1.1 billion. But one of their 10 core values and the reason why Amazon acquired them was because they wanted to deliver wow. That was one of their core values. And so they empowered their customer service reps so much that they could do almost anything as long as they were ensuring great customer experience. They actually borrowed this from Disney. If you think of how Disneyland is and what the people can do within Disneyland to create a magical experience, so it's very similar. That's another one you could use as this example. And so, for example, they could send flowers to a shopper. They could spend hours to help the shopper find exactly what they want. Or if it was out of stock, you know what? We can go buy it from a competitor and help you out that way. So they're really looking by creating a superior customer experience in that service. Men's Warehouse. They promised a free lifetime pressing of any product that you purchased, whether it was a suit, tuxedo, coat, or slacks. Well, that would just keep the customers coming back in more so that they could get free pressing of those types of things, and also they would buy more products. Actually, have met the founder of Men's Warehouse several times at some conferences. Sysco, one of the largest food distributors in North America, created free business reviews where they would essentially have consulting services for their clients. Because, okay, you have all these foods. Well, we're also going to help you design your menu. And then, of course, we will deliver the foods that help you do that. And then also the back of the house logistics. So, how do you get the food just in time and optimize your ordering so you don't order way too much and food spoils, or you don't order too little and run out? So, a lot of those types of things. Another area is channel. So this is where we're innovating delivery to the customers. So channel innovations change the way you connect offerings with customers from a delivery standpoint. So some examples is combine e-commerce with physical stores. You're seeing a lot more of that where it's not just one or the other, but it's both and. Delivery when and how customer wants. Minimal friction to obtain offering and selling directly when competition is using dealers or distributors. So, what are some examples of this? Well, first one, if you think quickly, is Tesla. Look at how Tesla does their sales. They don't do sales like any other car company. They do sales direct. Now, there's a lot of other reasons for that, but they also wanted to bypass dealership markups and the regulations that affect dealers, and also diluting the message of their car and the promotion of their car. So instead, they have showrooms, and then you can buy your custom Tesla online. So it's a completely different customer experience. You can also do free test drives anytime you want. So you schedule an appointment for that, and you can do that online. There's Nespresso, not something that existed back before the 90s, but Nespresso leveraged a capsule technology. So again, they leveraged a device to make coffee, just like any other coffee maker, but what they leveraged was a consumable, and that's what this capsule technology is, so that you could basically make one cup at a time. You don't make 12 cups because most people don't drink all that. There's a lot of waste. So it's a one cup at a time type deal. Well, in this case, what do they do? Well, the consumer needs to be able to get these types of things. So instead of just going through one retail partner, they have kiosks with partners with lots of retailers. They also have their own stores, and then you can also buy things directly online. So again, it's kind of a both and approach. Then you may have never heard of this group. It's called Mobile Telephone Network, or MTN. They develop a cell phone network in developing countries. But if you think about it, a cell phone network in developing countries isn't useful to the people unless they have more basic things met, such as water, such as electricity, such as maybe education. And a demand for a cell phone doesn't really make sense unless those other things are there. So what they've also done is they created an entire foundation that installs local power plants. And they're micro power plants. They're not these huge, gigantic things to create an electrical network, but it's also a place where they could plug in their phones and sell those later on. But those power plants and the other things that they do with the foundation is create education programs and water programs. So once people's basic needs were met, all of a sudden, what did they want? Well, they wanted the next level where they could communicate with each other. They needed to move money around, and they didn't have wired networks like we do in this country. So wireless was the way to go. And so all of a sudden, now there's demand for wireless networks where people could do all their banking via the phone. They could watch TV. They could listen to the radio via the phone. They could have their credit cards on their phone. Personal computing, that phone was also their computer. So they are one of the largest telephone companies, and telephone company is kind of a misnomer. They've actually created a network of systems in the developing world. So you will hear more about them later. Number nine is brand. This is where we're innovating representation of the enterprise or even the offering to create a memorable impression. So the brand innovation can make your customers remember and hopefully positively align themselves with your company. Now, if you do something really dumb, like let's say BP, where you basically had too much pressure and greed to speed up things, and then all of a sudden you blow a whale in the Gulf of Mexico, well, then there's a bad connotation with the brand. So it also means that if you build a strong brand, you also have to have a lot of goodwill out there with your brand. And if you mess up, you have to then go fix that. Some examples: convey distinct identities, evoke emotional or loyal connections, thread brand throughout the network channels and communications. So you see this oftentimes with marketing collateral, where they have different color schemes, different font schemes throughout. ASU does that itself, if you've ever noticed, and generate goodwill with a brand. So some good examples of this is Intel Inside. That was one of the first things that they did, and they started to do it with their television commercials. They were the first computer processing manufacturer who did anything like commercials. And at first they thought this was silly. Why are they doing that? But what they did is they generated perceived value. So even though they had competitors like AMD, once they started putting Intel Inside and promoting it, people intrinsically thought there was more value there because it was an Intel processor than something else. And it still continues today. You still see these stamps on laptops and things like that. Virgin, they started out as a mail order music company, and then they went into stores. Well, they quickly realized as that industry was changing that they needed to do something different. So they pivoted, and they pivoted not just in companies, but then their brand. They leveraged the brand that they already had and branded everything. So you have Virgin Airlines, you have, you name it, Virgin Space Exploration and things like that. And what they really try to do is dive into other industries using the Virgin brand. And they tried to get things that they thought were tired or dull and that needed a dose of fun is what they say. So they're lending their brand to all these different portfolio of companies. So really it's a huge conglomeration of different types of companies. Now you can look at it that way, or you can say, you know what, it's a conglomeration of a whole bunch of startups and existing companies using the Virgin name. So if one of them dies off, as Virgin Cola did, it doesn't necessarily kill the brand. The brand lives on through its other successful areas. The other is American Heart Association. If you've probably seen this and recognize it, it's the branding or the mark. It's called the heart check mark that they put on foods. And so it's usually what they put on foods that they say, no, this is a heart healthy food for you. And it's selected for certain nutrition profiles, and only certain products can get this. And then the manufacturers actually pay for this. Even though the American Heart Association is a nonprofit, this is a way to get sustainable money and kind of their certification stamp of approval on other things. And then they turn around and use those funds for nonprofit and social issues, a lot of research in the American Heart Association is funded with proceeds from these things. Finally, customer engagement is number 10, and this is where we're innovating and fostering compelling interactions. Customer engagement innovations understands the aspirations of your customers. You want to develop meaningful connections with those customers and your enterprise. So some examples is you want to make the customer's life better, more fulfilling, meaningful. You want to use social media space for mutual interaction with the customer. So this is where you're really trying to get them more engaged in the process, instill trust or partnership, or create intelligent, intuitive packaging, such as even having thank you cards that personalize the delivery of whatever your item is, like Tuft & Needle does that type of approach. Three big examples: Blizzard. They've created the massively multiplayer online, or MMOs, World of Warcraft. It's one of the biggest MMOs out there. There's other ones that have followed suit after this, such as Destiny and Elder Scrolls Online and things like that. but they're encouraging players to play together because some of the biggest prizes you can only win if you cooperate. Then there's Apple, of course. We've seen Apple in a lot of different areas. What do they do? Well, they have a VIP treatment for developers. So this isn't necessarily a customer per se, but it is engagement of their developers. So this is a little bit different tweak to this idea. They're actually having increased engagement with their developers. So what they create is this sense of scarcity and importance, a VIP treatment for these developers at this conference, which the conference is enormously expensive to get into. It's about $1,500 just to go. And you then get the rights to be the first chance to use and give feedback on their hardware and software developments, so whatever their innovations are. And then, of course, you want to go then and develop for those, the new features. And then there's Mint.com. You may or may not have heard of this. This is an online financial management system that makes things like budgeting, which is complex for some people, simple by basically getting all of your different financial account situations, including retirement accounts, and constantly updating information from that, tagging, categorized purchases, helping you form a budget automatically, and then giving you suggestions on how you could save money, also identify maybe investment approaches, things like that. They now have expanded into types of loan options if you need those types of things. So it's kind of one-stop shopping for not only your account management, but budgeting and savings and financial well-being. So those are the 10 individual types. Overall, what's even better is to mix and match innovation types. Why do we do that? Well, you're going to have a multiplier effect. So it increases that impact significantly. And then it produces surprising results because now you're doing something that's reinforcing itself. So that's why you get that multiplier effect. It also makes it much harder for the competition to follow what the heck you're doing because you have multiple different things going on at the same time. And you're putting a complementary effort into these items. Now, the warning here is don't try to innovate all of the types at the same time. That's going to be chaotic, and this is a symbol for chaos. So if you're trying to hit everything all at the same time, you're hitting nothing well. And you're not really innovating anything. You're just causing a cacophony. So pick, three things, four things tops, that you can work in a way that's complementary to each other and that reinforce each other, where you get that multiplier effect. So you can pick profit model, product performance and channel, or customer engagement, service, product system and process, and then you'll find different ways of doing this. Now, this is just a quick summary of all these things, just so you have an example and an alignment according to the book. But we're going to dive into some of these different ways that you mix and match later on in the course. All right. That is about it for me. So thank you so much, and I will see you in class.